discuss a very important topic about the use of rituximab in kidney transplantation. First, we need to revise the role of B lymphocytes in kidney transplant before starting my talk. It acts as effective antigen-presenting cells, antibody secretion, cytokine production, lymphoid aggregation in acute and chronic allograft rejection, and secretion of cytokines and post-stimulation molecules. Activation of B lymphocytes to form antibody start by antigen-presenting cell and the MHC class II. There must be several steps till formation of plasma cells, secretion of antibodies in addition to activated T helper lymphocytes. The mechanism of action, rituximab is a monoclonal antibody that binds to CD20 present on normal and neoplastic B lymphocytes present in the peripheral blood, bone marrow, and lymph nodes. Single dose of rituximab causes long-term elimination of B lymphocytes in peripheral blood and kidney tissue with less effect on lymph nodes. Then it passes by one of three pathways. First, it binds to the cell surface FC receptor with activation of antibody-dependent cell-mediated cytotoxicity and cell lysis, or complement activation, and lastly, apoptosis. Rituximab indication in kidney transplantation includes ABO-incompatible kidney transplantation, high-risk type recipient, HLA-incompatible transplantation, post-transplant lymphoproliferative disease, acute and chronic antibody-mediated rejection, recurrent and de novo lymphocytes after transplantation, and lastly, induction therapy. This is a very nice recent review article about the use of rituximab in kidney transplantation. Its dose is 375 mg/m² surface area, given either weekly or every 2 weeks according to the indication or the protocol. If you are going to use plasmapheresis after rituximab, please remember that the AUC for rituximab is reduced by 26% if plasmapheresis is done within 3 days after infusion. In ABO incompatible kidney transplantation, this figure shows the changes in the preconditioning protocols. And as we see, rituximab replaces the invasive splenectomy maneuver. This is the immunosuppressive regimen showing use of IVIG and rituximab as induction therapy, followed by immunosuppression with steroid tacrolimus and MMF. The outcome of incompatible ABO kidney transplantation is comparable to compatible cases regarding patient and graft survival, acute myeloid rejection, and infectious complications. However, long-term outcome need to be studied more in details, and the presence of national donor exchange program causes decline in the desensitization protocols. These are some of the many studies done for ABO incompatible kidney transplantation. Every study showed the mechanism, the methodology, endpoint, and the study limitations. And this is a systematic review published in 2014, collecting 21 studies, 10 of them for ABO incompatible kidney transplantation. These studies show that it is effective as the invasive previous splenectomy maneuver, but the evidence is still needs more study to be used in this issue. The limits include lack of controlled studies, limited sample size, short follow-up, and poorly defined endpoints. Regarding the second point, it's used in desensitization. It is used with IVIG and plasmapheresis to decrease antibody level, increase odds of transplantation in sensitized individuals, and the lower instance of early rejection. Many studies are concerned with this point, investigating this point, like this study. However, to conclude that this evidence-based still needs more study, as there are many limitations, including retrospective design, no formal comparison group, dosing is not standardized, immunosuppression in the form of induction, maintenance, and outcome are not standardized. Still, the antibody level is drop is intransient and incomplete with significant rebound. Also, cross-match and is unaccepted in all patients. The rate of DSA and the drop of antibody-mediated rejection remains high. Additionally, rituximab has no effect on CD27 memory B cell and the CD138 positive plasma cells. Regarding its relationship with cross-match, if you give rituximab to a patient, it can produce positive B cell cytotoxic response. So, flow and the cytotoxic cross-match and BRA determination. If you want to do it successfully, you need either Polonese treatment of these cells or removal of circulating rituximab by immunomagnetic bead absorption. For the problems with the use of Polonese, this recent study showed the use of Polonese independent method cytolytic course matching of rituximab using an anti-rituximab monoclonal antibody as a pre-coating step. Regarding the use in antibody-mediated rejection, the essence of antibody-mediated rejection differ according to the selected population. The use of IVIG and plasmapheresis is the main treatment, and recent trials for the use of bortezomib and rituximab. There is a meta-analysis study collecting 249 patients with partial improvement in graft function. However, there are limitations in the form of positive of prospective and randomized controlled trials with non-uniform definition of response. There was a double-blind randomized trial of 38 patients. All of them have biopsy-proven acute antibody-mediated rejection. They were given rituximab on the fifth day. The end point was graft loss or no improvement at 1 year, and the MELF score or fibrosis score at 1 and 6 months. They conclude that there is no benefit from its use, no difference in graft loss and proteinuria. However, it is underpowered. Few studies investigated the use of rituximab in refractory cases. These are main studies again for its use in humoral rejection, like all these rejection. It's used in chronic antibody-mediated rejection. A degree has a beneficial effect on graft survival, function, and proteinuria, but it doesn't reach the level to be evidence-based. It can be used early. It has a limited role if you use it late and advanced stage. All studies are non-randomized, single-center, retrospective, better chosen outcome, differ in the chronicity stage and in serum creatinine, so we cannot put it as a rule in the treatment. Some of the studies used of the use of rituximab in humoral rejection. This study, the recent study, analyzed the retrospective analysis of 12 kidney transplant recipients. All of them received 2 doses of rituximab 1 week apart. There was no change in renal function in the form of serum creatinine and proteinuria. There was no change in chronicity in these, however, active lesion and the level of CD20 in the renal allograft were significantly improved. This is a meta-analysis and review article for the treatment of antibody-mediated rejection in kidney transplantation, collecting 21 studies after a previous report, and concluded that numerous studies evaluating the use of rituximab show little or no difference in early graft survival. The efficacy of other complement inhibitors and bortezomib remains unclear. This is an abstract done on a retrospective analysis of 27 patients using a combination of IVIG and rituximab. They conclude that the rate of graft failure and the loss of graft function is improved with the use of this regimen. The key points is that no consensus for the use of rituximab in acute and chronic antibody-mediated rejection, and the large multi-center randomized controlled trials are still strongly needed. The use of recurrent membrane trials include recurrent membranous nephropathy, recurrent FSGS, recurrent NKIGA, and MPGN and lymphocyte trials. The table shows the rate of recurrence and the graft loss from recurrent lesion with the highest in MPGN and FSGS. For membranous, the use of rituximab showed by many studies to improve graft function and to have a negligible effect on proteinuria, with different rate of instance of recurrence. For example, this showed half 50% rate of recurrence with improvement of renal function after 4 doses of rituximab. This study showed 42 instances of recurrence. Recurrence occurred in 8 patients, all of them given 2 doses of rituximab. There was partial or complete response at 2 years, and the resolution of electron dense deposits as effect on the tissue. This study showed 44% instance of recurrence, all of them given 2 doses of rituximab every 2 weeks or 4 doses weekly, with a stabilization or improvement of proteinuria. Regarding the value of the use of phosphorylated E2 receptor was studied in these 2 investigations, and conclude the persistence of or the appearance of phospholipase E2 receptor is associated with resistant disease, while distribution of phospholipase E2 receptor resulted in improvement of proteinuria. So there is a question, can we use rituximab to prevent recurrence in these cases? Still needs more research. Which patients now will benefit from the use of rituximab? No firm conclusion in view of heterogeneity of patient population, disease characteristics, and retrospective design. Recurrent FSGS is the gold standard of treatment is plasma exchange, and there are few case records of the use of rituximab alone or in combination with plasmapheresis. The gold predictors for response in FSGS include young age, normal abdomen, and less rituximab infusion, and and a few studies investigated its use in high-risk population. Recurrent MK is studied only in native kidney, but no positive transplant recurrence. It has no data for its use in recurrent lupus nephritis. Case reports only for MGN, and there is a current phase 4 randomized controlled trial for recurrent IgA nephropathy, currently recruiting patients. Again, the limitation retrospective design, single center, non-randomized, reporting bias, use of other agents that decrease proteinuria, so we cannot reach evidence-based recommendation. Key points from this recurrent immune nephritis include the use of in-membrane cisplomycin, beneficial effect on FSGS, and no evidence for use in lupus nephritis, IgA, and MMGA. It can be used as the gold standard, the gold treatment for post-transplant lymphoproliferative disorder with decreased or reduced production of immune suppressive regimen. It is best in CD20 cases positive, monomorphic, polymorphic, diffuse large B cell type. If you have lymphoma, CNS lymphoma, or CD20 negative, the response will be poor. This is a review article for the prospective trials using the rituximab with remission rate up to 50-70%. And if the patient is progressive or partial response, you can give rituximab followed by shock protocol. Key points in the use is accepted by oncology and the transplant specialists, although a small number of patients. Regarding its impact on vaccination, if used rituximab, it has significantly associated with loss of positive vaccination after transplantation. The adverse effects of rituximab is generally well tolerated, however, you have infusion reactions which range from either mild, like urticaria or hypotension, to severe, like ARDS, myocardial infarction, VF. Downset is half an hour to 2 hours. If severe enough, you should stop treatment. Generally, pre-treatment with acetaminophen and the antihistaminics are good. Main cutaneous reactions can occur and can be severe and fatal, like toxic epidermal necrolysis. Infectious complications are common after the use of rituximab in the form of mainly CMV reactivation, activation of tuberculosis, bacterial, viral, and fungal infection, and activation of hepatitis B with the fatal or progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy. This study showed the rate and the time of complication with the most common cytomegalovirus and the more instance of complication of bacterial and viral complication occurring 6 months after infusion. This figure shows the effect of rituximab on hepatitis B reactivation. However, this point was studied in a recent study showing the incidence of hepatitis B after kidney transplantation with low-dose rituximab infusion. It is a retrospective study including a large number of kidney transplant recipients. The rate of recurrence was, or reactivation was very low, only found in one patient in the rituximab arm. So, if you are going to use low-dose rituximab in kidney transplant recipient without prophylaxis associated with low incidence of hepatitis B reactivation. However, more trials are needed and more studies are needed to reach conclusions. About the monitoring and the treatment of hepatitis B virus, if you have hepatitis B surface antigen positive patient and anti-hepatitis B positive patient, initiate prophylactic antiviral therapy utilizing antiviral with low rate of viral resistance, and to continue during and for 6 to 12 months after completing the treatment. If you have hepatitis B surface antigen negative and anti-HBC positive patient, monitoring for hepatitis B reactivation using the ALT and hepatitis B virus DNA done every 3 months during the treatment. Antiviral therapy is initiated prophylactic or at the first time of hepatitis B virus reactivation. Conclusions, the evidence-based use of rituximab in kidney transplantation in all the previous indications remains limited. The role of rituximab is suggested by uncontrolled studies and need to be confirmed by randomized controlled trials. For diseases with rare occurrence like post-transplanted pulmonary nephritis, transplant centers must form a consortium and use uniform outcome and intervention to increase the power of the results. Studies are needed to investigate its role in combination with novel therapies and anti-plasma cell and the various B-cell subtests role. Finally, I'd like to invite you to submit your article online on our peer-reviewed journal, Journal of Egyptian Society of Nephrology and Transplantation. Thank you.